From coast to coast and around the world, it's time to praise the Lord. Praise the Lord covers the major Christian events in America and across the world from the heart of Europe. To the tip of Africa. From the centers of Asia. To Central and South America. Welcome to the number one Christian network in the world. Joining us from New York City are Rabbi and founder of World Ministries and the Jerusalem Center, Jonathan Gorn. Speaker, author, and producer, Michael Frenzies. Lead pastor of Faith Church, Connecticut and New York City, Frank Sandora. Singer, songwriter, and recording gospel music artist, Bashawn Mitchell. Ready to take your calls. Prayer partners around America.
Lift him high, God and God alone.
He's God and God alone.
Lift him high, high upon the throne.
High upon the throne.
Lift him high. He's God and God alone.
He's God and God alone.
him high, high upon the throne. Lift him high, God and God alone. Everybody, clap your hands. Everybody, take a stand. Everybody, don't you know? It's time to praise the Lord. What time is it?
It's time to praise the Lord.
What time is it, y'all?
It's time to praise the Lord.
Well, somebody better praise him then. Come on. You know what? I'm glad to see your face up here in this place. I'm so glad to see your face here tonight. Coast to coast, shore to shore, round the world here to praise the Lord. Glad to see your face here tonight. All blood-bought, red-hot believers in the house say Jesus. Believers in the house say he is Lord.
He is Lord.
Y'all believe the Bible is the word of God. Y'all believe what it says is true and right. Y'all believe that Christ rose from the dead. Y'all believe that he is here tonight. You might have rolled in from coast to coast. Could even travel from shore to shore. Maybe you've flown from around the world. But how many want to just praise the Lord? Jesus Christ alive with power. You ready for a miracle? Your heart's on fire, you got the voice. Let's welcome each other, make a joyful noise. Up here in this, so glad. Here tonight, we've come from coast to shore to shore, around the world, here to praise the Lord. Glad to see your face here tonight. Say Jesus.
Jesus.
All blood-bought, red-hot believers in the house say he is Lord.
He is Lord.
Y'all believe the Bible is the word of God. Y'all believe what it says is true and right. Y'all believe that Christ rose from the dead. Y'all believe that he is here tonight. You might have rolled in from coast to coast. Could have even traveled from shore to shore. Maybe you've flown from around the world. But how many want to just praise the Lord? It's Jesus Christ alive with power. You ready for a miracle here right now? Your heart's on fire, you got the voice. Let's welcome each other, make a joyful noise. Up here in,
so glad.
Here tonight, we come from coast to coast, shore to shore, around the world here to praise the Lord. Glad. To see your face. You at home, we're so glad to see your face. Here in New York City, we are glad to see your face. So glad to see your face here tonight. Woo! How many are glad tonight? Come on now. Is an awesome God, he reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God, he reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. How many know he's an awesome God here tonight? Awesome, and he's alive in New York City tonight. When the sky was void in the dark of the night, our God is an awesome God. He spoke into the darkness and created the light.
Our God is an awesome God.
Judgment and wrath he poured out on Sodom. Mercy and grace he gave us at the cross. I hope it's not too quickly forgotten that our God is an awesome God. Somebody say it. Our God, He reigns, heaven above, wisdom, power, and love. Our God, our God, our God is an awesome God. He, heaven above, with wisdom, power, and love. Our God, lift your voice, sing it again. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God, our God is an awesome God. He reigns heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God, our God, our God, our God is an awesome God. If you believe He reigns, lift your voice and say, He reigns. He reigns. He reigns. He reigns. Our God, our God. He reigns. He reigns. He reigns. Somebody give Him praise in this house here tonight. Is Jesus alive and well living in New York City tonight? Is He? Somebody say Jesus is the best thing that has ever happened to me. If you believe that, give Him one more hand clap.
Well, y'all are acting like you know Jesus personally or something. We have some special guests here tonight, and they have brought some of their peeps with them. From the Restoration Christian Ministries. We now know you're here. Pastor Keith Campbell is here tonight. Pastor Keith Campbell. And from Christ for the World International Fellowship and Bible College, Bishop David Taylor and Pastor Delia. Delia Edwards. Yes. Delia. That's Delia. Delia. I got it all wrong. Dahlia. And from the Community Bible Institute, Dr. Barbara Jackman. Yes. Okay, we got some really great guests here tonight that are from all different walks of life and have testimonies from what God can do in so many different areas, so I got to get started. We have an incredible vocalist and singer who was nominated for 11 Stellar Awards in 2012. Usually that's enough, but this brother won 6 of them. Not only that, he was Artist of the Year, Male Vocalist of the Year. But that just wasn't enough. He was Praise and Worship CD of the Year. Urban Inspirational Singer of the Year. Best Dressed Brother of the Year. He is a singer, a songwriter, and one of Christian music's great gospel artists. He's here tonight. We're going to talk to him a little bit first. Would you please welcome Vashawn Mitchell?
Hey, brother. How you doing? Doing great. Doing great.
So tell me, were you the best dressed brother of the year?
Well, you said it, so I must be.
You must be. Man, you just won everything.
Wow.
So you write your own songs, right?
I write most of my own music. For that particular project, I didn't write Nobody Greater, someone else did. But over the years, I've written for other artists, like, you know, Smokey Norfolk, Vanessa Bell Armstrong, Bishop Paul Morton, and God allowed me to write for myself. So,
yeah.
Excited.
I always like an artist who writes because, you know, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks, so
absolutely.
You can always tell what somebody's thinking.
Yeah.
And where their heart's at and where their worship is at and how they feel towards the Lord, because you can look at their words.
Absolutely, absolutely.
You know? So have you ever, like, just written lyrics, or you write music, or you do both?
You know, I kind of do it all. This new project that I have out called Unstoppable, I started writing from a perspective.
Now, Unstoppable, that's out now, right?
It's out right now, right
okay.
now, yeah. As a writer, though, as a writer, I wanted to make a concept project that kind of talks about being unstoppable and be that roadmap for people who are in between what God said and what he's done. So, you know, that's what it's really all about.
Roadmap between what God said and what he's done.
Yeah. Yeah.
Somebody write that down. That was a good one. Just to get a little background, how did you get started?
I started as a minister of music at my local church in Chicago, where, you know, the Chicago church was kind of recording, so I started writing for them and teaching the choir on a weekly basis. And after a while, you know, people started liking my music. And I was like, thank God. I met with the pastor and I said, you know, I want to do my own thing. And he gave me his blessing. And then I started recording my own music from there.
Do you think that most great or successful artists over a long period of time pretty much start as praise and worship leaders in their church?
I do believe so. I believe learning to serve allows you to learn to lead. And God, yeah, yeah. That's good. God honored those who serve. So once he take you to the top, he know you can handle it because you served your way up instead of just made your way up. So,
well, man, you are... You're just saying everything right tonight.
Hey.
You're right. So when you release a record, do you go out and tour it? Do you just put the record out there and then just go from church to church? How does the rest of that work for you?
You know, normally we release a single to radio and to the internet so that, you know, that's the new, people listen to music on the internet most often.
Right.
Then after that, we do a promo tour, just going around different radio stations, different cities, promoting the record, promoting the sound, preferably that it will bless, you know, churches and different places we go to in different places. And then we release it into the stores and then we promote it once again for it to come out of the stores. It's really, we thank God for labels and distribution because it allows our ministry to go further than we can go sometimes. You know,
right.
Other cultures, other countries, the nations are singing our music because we're distributed so well. So it's a process to it. You know, as long as you follow the process and you really allow God to be your guide, you know, we're able to make it to the top.
So a lot of people don't realize all the work that goes into just before you see somebody or you hear the record or you see them on TV. There's a whole lot that went into it. So you have to go on a promotional tour before like a regular singing tour.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And how long would something like that last for you?
Well, normally it's about a month or so, where you're just going around to different cities that allow you entry to kind of do radio interviews and TV broadcasts and sing a song or two.
They ask you the same questions over and over.
Same questions over and over again. But it's good because every time you answer the questions, you actually get new revelation, you know, because I like to be a, yeah. I am a... As a songwriter like yourself, as a songwriter, it's important that our message gets across the right way. So it's always great to ask questions so that we can always answer the questions of the message we want to put out.
Is there any questions that you wish somebody would ask you, or something about yourself that they just don't know?
Wow, that's good.
Because usually they're asking the same thing all the time.
Yeah.
How'd you get started, about the music. Yeah. But there's more to you than just the music, because obviously those words, those lyrics, those experiences have to come from something. You have to have lived something.
Yes. Yeah.
So what are some of the areas you wish that they would talk about?
You know what? They're starting to talk about it now. You know, for so long we've seen gospel, so people don't think we have real lives. Mm. So recently, we've been asked about our life, you know, how we grew up, you know, how my mom was a teenager. My dad was not around. I just met him 3 years ago. Those are questions people want to know, what's going on
with you? 3 years ago?
Yeah, 3 years ago. You know, so the music comes from that place, you know, once we met, and there was a healing that took place and things of that sort. So it is, yeah.
Let's get back to that 3 years ago thing.
Back to that 3 years ago, yeah.
So you'd never met him before?
Never met him before, yeah.
In 3 years?
Yeah.
So what was it like meeting him? What was the circumstances that brought you guys together?
It was like meeting myself. It was the funniest thing in the world, because I'd never met him before. I was 35, and God forbid, he had been diagnosed with cancer. Thank God he's still here. Amen. So we decided to meet. He reached out to me.
So now, did you know about him?
I knew about him.
You know, but you never met him?
Never met him.
Did you try to find him?
Years ago, when I was young, I did, but when it didn't really work, my grandparents took good care of me. So right. I grew up in the 70s and 80s, so, you know, everyone took care of you, so you were pretty good.
Right.
But I always wanted to know, you know, that missing piece for my life. So when I met him, I called him, and it was like, I said, hey, what's up? He said, hey, what's up? I said, this is Vashon. This is Jesse. So it was like talking to yourself, very nonchalant like I am. But I have to say, over the last few years, just talking to each other, getting to know each other, is like finishing the rest of the puzzle that was missing from my life. So I don't know if we can ever redo what was done before, but we can build off of today. So that's what we're doing.
Did you notice that he like looked like you or anything?
Yeah,
he sounded like you?
He looked darker than me, but he looks like me. We sound like when we're talking, and it's almost like, you know, meeting that person that completed you. You know what I'm saying? So,
did you find that you had a rapport somewhere in there? Because obviously you didn't know a lot about each other's lives. I mean, because obviously
right,
you were
right.
Apart. But is there like some sort of instinctive sort of rapport that you had with him?
It was, and it was weird.
I'm fascinated with this.
It's
because
it's
I don't know
things.
What it would be like.
Yeah, it's little things. Like I grew up, my mom. Family is amazing. My grandparents raised me, but I like spicy food, and I'm trying to figure out why I like spicy food and they don't. So I eat hot sauce and everything like that. I like spicy food. Well, his whole family is from New Orleans, and that's all they do is cook gumbo and spicy food. So it's certain little things that came to life was like, wow, this is really answering those questions that I may have had, you know, over the years. You know, I don't judge him for not being there that much, because he was a teenager. Mm. So, you know, I don't think I want to be raised by a teenager anyway. So, but I do commend him for wanting to meet me in our adult life so we can move forward from there.
Did you notice any mannerisms that were the same? Anything that he did that you said, ooh, I do the same thing?
You know what, I don't know about mannerisms, but I am fascinated with cars.
Uh-huh.
And he has like some antique cars collection, you know, things of that sort. So I think like small, more instinct type of things that I find myself understanding that we both like the same things, same type of restaurants, same places to travel, you know, things of that sort.
Now, did he know you were a recording artist and everything?
He did. He found out. Well, I have a street name 2 blocks from where he lived at, so he had to see me some type of way. But
you have a street named?
Yeah.
After you?
Yeah.
Like Vashon Boulevard or something?
It's the longest name in the city.
What?
Vashon Mitchell Street.
Get out.
Yeah.
Are you kidding me? Let's see. So if I get 6 Stellar Awards, I get my own street?
Just me.
Just you?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, that is fascinating. So when he listens to your music, was he like, man, where'd you get all this? You
know? Yeah, he always, whenever we talk, it's funny. He said, man, the ladies downtown, they was talking about you. I was like, that's my son. I mean, I was like, okay, cool. How you doing? Thanks. You know? But he's very excited. It brings joy to his day to see that I'm spreading the gospel, you know, other than anything else. So.
I think what's most fascinating about that, you know, you can meet at a certain point in your life and put the past in the past and start from where you're at.
Absolutely.
You know, because that's so important, because, you know, we all have a past.
Yeah.
We all have stuff we're trying to forget.
Yeah.
And stuff we're trying to move towards. And to be able to do that, that's the beginning of a relationship.
Yeah.
Tell me about the Unstoppable Movement.
Yeah.
Now, the record is called Unstoppable.
The record's called Unstoppable, but the mindset is more important than the record.
Okay.
It's really a message of empowerment and encouragement. It's National Mentoring Month is coming up in January, so I want to encourage everyone to empower young people to understand that they are unstoppable because God is working on them to get to where he wants them to be. Mm. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
Me and my nephew, we have our prayer time, and he said, on earth as it is in heaven. And when he went to bed, I thought about that thing, and then realized that God has something in store for us that we haven't seen on earth yet that's brewing up in heaven.
Oh.
So the only thing that can stop us is ourselves.
Right.
We continue to walk out who God knows that we are. So I'm on a mission to encourage every young person, everybody in general, to fulfill your dreams, fulfill your purpose, because you are unstoppable. And that's what it is.
Did you write the songs for this Unstoppable?
I did. I wrote most of the songs. Like I said earlier, I wanted to serve as a roadmap for people who get in the middle. You know, life comes when you say, oh, I'm unstoppable. Then life hits you. Be like, oh, God.
Yeah.
You know, I really wanted to be that roadmap that you can go and get a song like You Carried Me, or song, or the worship medley, or God, My God, or I'm Holding On to You. Those songs you can pull out whenever you need them.
Right.
You know, you can just pull it out so it can be your strength, so it can be your power, and you can just depend on God.
Now, when you're writing all the songs to this record, do you keep the theme of Unstoppable in mind so they all kind of thread together?
Yeah, the theme is there, but it's also like, I believe praise and worship builds our power, builds our strength. And the more we give God praise, the more he fights for us.
That's right.
So, and that's what it's about.
Is there any one particular song, any particular, you know, a couple of lyrics or something like that from one of the songs that kind of capsulize the record?
Yes. It's a song called Unstoppable.
Okay.
It says, everyone has a story, it's in the book of life, but it's not over until God says it's done. Amen. Which means that no matter what you go through, up and down or around or a circle, whatever, God still has the final say in your story.
Yes. Now, you wrote that.
I wrote that one.
Tell us about the mentoring. You are a part of the Big Brothers. You got appointed to the National Faith-Based Spokesperson for Big Brothers and Big Sisters?
Yes, yes.
So you're one of the spokespeople for that?
I'm one of the spokespersons for Big Brother, Big Sister, and it's probably one of the most accomplishing parts of my career and my life because, you know, being raised by my grandparents and different mentors around the area and music mentors over the years, I understand what the young people go through. So it's great to partner with an agency like Big Brother, Big Sister to provide that influence, to provide male role model is not just playing basketball or football or things of that sort, but there's some great males out there that are doing other things that other males can connect to and find a career, find a job. And what's important to me is that don't just look at what we do on stage, but look at what makes us do what we do. So I teach about engineers and about Pro Tools and musicianship, just kind of building up our next generation so that they can understand that they can become anything, even if you come from a background that's not so perfect. You know, you can still accomplish what you know you can become.
How long have you been doing Big Brother?
I've been in partnership with Big Brother, Big Sister for the last 4 years. Mm-hmm. And it's really great because I get to go around the world and speak about Big Brother, Big Sister. I get to see young people come and lives are changed. I've seen one guy who's 14 4 years ago. Now he's 18. He's about to graduate and go to college. And it's like to see that growth and to know when I got there, he was bad as ever. I didn't know he was going to make it. But he made it. And he made it because of those mentors in his life that thought enough for him to put the forefront of mind.
Well, I can only listen to you talk about your music just so long before I have to hear it. You got a song called Holding On?
Yeah.
Could you do it right now?
Oh, yeah.
You tear this place up?
Let's do it.
All right, man. Rashawn Mitchell, Holding On. Thank you, brother.
My faith is stronger than it's ever been before, and I will forever keep my eyes on you. You hold the world
in the palm of your hand.
And you know my ending.
You know my ending.
Way before.
Way before.
Here we go. So no matter what comes my
name,
I will never lose my
name.
I'll keep holding on.
To you.
Yeah. And nothing can separate us.
It's ever been before,
and I will forever, keep my eyes on you. And you hold the world, my God.
You hold the world
in the palm,
in the palm of your hand.
And you know my ending.
You know my ending.
Wait.
Way before I began.
Here we go. So no matter what comes my way, I will never lose my faith. I will keep
holding on
to you. Yeah,
nothing can separate us.
This is why, because you are the source of my strength. You're the strength of my life. You're my shepherd.
I will worship, I will praise.
Say forever.
Forever.
Yeah.
And always.
I will worship. Said
praise.
I will worship.
Thank you,
Father.
I will give you all the glory. I will worship.
Now this is why, because you are the source. Come on. You are the source.
My shepherd.
And I have no fear.
I'm holding on to you.
Say you are the source
of my strength.
You're the strength of my life. You're my shepherd.
Now you're all acting like a bunch of fanatics now. That's an anointing that has to come back again tonight. We gotta bring it back. And he writes that stuff and he records it. That's just it's just an anointed man of God, you know? Has a heart for ministry. Has a heart for people, for mentoring. It's good to know that type of stuff about somebody that's up there ministering, that there's other layers to that person. So when they sing those songs, you kind of know where they're coming from. You know, it has that much more meaning to it. So I'm glad that he's here tonight, and I'm glad he's going to be singing a couple more songs before the evening's out too. So. I don't know about you, but I've always been fascinated with, mob movies. You know, you watch these gangster movies about these Italians that they get together, they get this thing, it's called the mob or the mafia. Yeah, we've all seen the movies, The Godfather, one, two, three. I don't know about three. But, and of course, The Sopranos and Goodfellas and all that stuff. We've seen so many of these shows. But tonight, we got somebody here who was actually a part of a real life mob and was a real life mob member. And he was a captain in the Columbo crime family, one of the five families here. And the captain is the next guy up before you become the godfather, which means, you know, that's the guy that's in charge of the whole family. You all know kind of what I'm talking about. You've seen those movies. If you've seen The Godfather, this would have been the guy like Clemenza or Tessio before the Don Corleone. But then he would have been the Don Corleone. And or if you've watched, you know, like The Sopranos, he would have been Paulie Walnuts. Well, I don't know about that. I don't think he would have did that. But one of those guys that dedicates their life to the family, and he made one of those oaths that they make, and this was his life. And one of the only few guys to ever make it out of the mob alive. Or not in prison. Because all the guys that he grew up with and all the guys that were his contemporaries and all the Sammy the Bulls and the John Gottis and all those guys, of course, they're all either in prison or they're gone. This guy's here. He found the Lord while he was in prison. He'll give a little bit of his testimony here tonight. And but his testimony is strong. He wrote a book about his life called Blood Covenant, his autobiography. He has the newest book called I'll Make You an Offer You Can't Refuse. Don't know where he got that idea from. And he just came out with a movie about his life called God the Father. It was released on Halloween night. And it's going to be re-released again on Easter. And it's a fascinating movie. It's about his life and how, you know, Rudolph Giuliani was after him. He was one of the first guys that was prosecuted under the RICO statutes where he was busting all those mob guys and putting them all in jail. I mean, the history and the life this guy leads was the real thing. And would you please welcome tonight, without further ado, Michael Franzese. There he is. Now, you know, a lot of these mob guys, they all had nicknames, you know, like Louis the Nose and Frankie the Lip. You know, and when I was a kid, my father gave me a nickname because I wanted to be a boxer. He called me Kid Candle. I said, why you call me that? He says, because one blow and you're out. And did you ever have a nickname growing up, you know, that was kind of associated with
you? You know, not really. No? But when I started going out to California, they started calling me the Yuppie Don. I never liked that.
You never liked that?
I'm a New York guy, no, but that was it. I didn't have a nickname.
So probably because you come from another generation, right? And you were a different type of mobster, in a sense. You didn't follow a lot of the preconceived traditions of what the other guys were.
Yeah, but I want to tell you that, you know, these names, the way we got these nicknames, we weren't really, you know, we didn't put a lot of thought behind it. There was a guy they called Chickenhead, and that's because he used to shoot off the heads of chickens. Another guy called Many Eggs because he loved eggs. I mean, so it wasn't like we were real original with these names, but I was kind of a different breed, I would say, Carmen. Yeah.
So now, but your father was in the mob,
yeah.
way back in the day.
Right.
Tell us a little bit about your dad.
Well, my dad, his name is Sonny Franzese, and I came into the life through him. Originally, he didn't want this for me. He wanted me to go to school and be a doctor. And I was on that road, but he got in some real trouble back in the 60s. He drew a 50-year prison sentence for conspiracy to rob banks. And I love my dad, idolized him as a kid growing up. And Joe Colombo was the boss of my family when Dad went away. And he kind of took me under his wing. And I was really influenced by the guys and wanted to help my dad get out of prison. So I lost interest in school and visited my dad in Leavenworth Penitentiary. You know, I told him I'm not going to school anymore, and he said, well, if you're going to be on the street, he was upset originally. He said, but if you're going to be on the street, I want you on the right way, and the right way to him was to become a member of his life. That's how it started. My dad today, he'll be 98 years old in February.
Wow.
Unfortunately, sadly, he's still in prison. He was in and out a few times, but he's back in now. He's the oldest living federal inmate, and he's the oldest living made man in America. My dad's really a legend in this life. He goes back to Lucky Luciano and all these guys. So
I was watching an interview with a lot of these different singers, when they interview them about the people that they've met in their life. And they had a Tom Jones. Y'all, if you remember Tom Jones, they were asking him some of the people he met. And because a lot of these guys would sing at these clubs in New York, and he said there was only one time that he was ever scared of anybody in his whole life, of all the guys that he met, because you meet all sorts of people in the entertainment field. He says there was a guy named Sonny Franzese. He says when he looked at me, he says I just felt like cold ice water go down my neck, and he was a major star at the time. And so your dad had that type of, ice-cold stare. When he walked in a room, he was the guy that was in charge. He was the enforcer. He was the muscle. He was the real deal.
He was, old-time guy, but special kind of guy. But, I remember those days. We used to go to the Copacabana when I was a kid. And, if you ever went to the Copa, it was probably the best place ever to see an act.
Right.
Back then. And, I met everybody through him, from Sinatra to Sammy Davis to everybody. We were all friendly. And I just watched the respect that they gave him. And, my dad was one, he would never bring what was going on outside into the house. He always tried to leave it outside. But, I heard those stories, and, of course, I got to see things later on. But, that's the same dad that used to chase us around the house, would try to give us cod liver oil as kids, And, we would get over on him or all that. But on the street, he was a different kind of guy.
When they said that they wanted to do a movie about your life, this particular movie is like a documentary. It has drama in it. It has animation. It has so many different elements. I've never seen all those things combined. Who was it that decided the different elements that would go into this movie, God the Father?
Carmen, they've been trying to make a movie on my life for the last 20 years, and they always wanted to make a Goodfellas or something like that. And, Hollywood, up until recently, was really not interested in the faith part of your life, and that's who I am. And if they didn't want to make the movie that way, I was never interested. But this is kind of a documentary feature, true life drama. I mean, everything you see is exactly what happened. But the style that they used is unique because so many churches are showing it, so we didn't want to be offensive, but we wanted to be real in how we showed the movie, because I came from a very dark life. And in order to understand what God has done in my life, you have to understand where I came from,
Right.
I tell people all the time, and they wanted to kind of, I said, listen, if I was a good mob guy, well, then God didn't do that much, right? Because I was a good guy. But so what we did in this film, we combined a lot of different elements to tell the story. There's 18 minutes of stock footage from NBC and all the other networks. And unfortunately, Carmen, I never realized why I was such a target, but I was in jail when a lot of this stock footage came out. When I got to see it later on, I said, no wonder I was in so much trouble. But we have stock footage. We have some dance sequences because I met my wife, who eventually led me to the Lord, and she was a dancer.
I read the book. She was coming out of the pool. You were producing a movie, and she was coming out of the pool.
I got to tell the audience. Yeah. I'm producing a movie. I was in the film business way back then. I'm producing a movie. It was kind of a breakdance movie. Actually, Smokey Robinson brought me the script. He and I were friends at the time. And so we're filming this breakdance, contemporary West Side Story type of film in South Florida. I had everybody staying in a hotel. I'm sitting by the pool on a Sunday afternoon, totally entrenched in a mob. This is who I was. All of a sudden, out of the water comes this gorgeous 20-year-old girl. So everything went in slow motion. And, she didn't want anything to do with me. She ran from me at the time, but I pursued her, and God used her to change and save my life, no doubt.
She must be breathing a sigh of relief today. Yeah.
I think so, She's actually in the green room watching me on television. She didn't want to come out. She said, I've heard you about 1,000 times.
Now, she wrote a book, too, right?
She did.
This Life of Ours, right? Was it called
This Thing of Ours.
This Thing of Ours. I read that book. I read your book. And it's the people that you had to interact with. I mean, you were interacting on a mob level with guys like Sammy the Bull and John Gotti and guys like that. I was fascinated with one of the negotiations you had to have with these guys. And I mean, everybody was so different that every time you had a meeting, in many ways, you kind of took your life in your hands.
Well, you did, because, you know, we had sit-downs. We didn't have meetings, and everything was decided at a sit-down. But, you know, God rest his soul, but with John, I had a lot of run-ins with John. You know, socially, we had a great time, but business-wise, he was difficult to deal with, and we had some issues. And John was the type of guy that could never lose an argument. It just, his ego wouldn't allow it. So before you go into the room, you have to understand how to deal with him, what you want. You got to make him think he won, but you come out of there with what you want. And you know, Carmen, I learned more things on the street that helped me later on in life. I have to say that I had some very valuable experiences that really helped me later on, really.
You know, I was curious about that. Is there anything that you learned, you know, in the life of having to negotiate with your life on the line that you could apply to just practical business? Or, you know, I hate to say, is there anything that you could apply to ministry? But I don't know if I can say that or not. But probably, right? A little bit, you know?
Well, I don't know about that.
Ministry's a tough business sometimes. I mean,
well, you know, I did write that book. Yeah. That's for sure. I mean, I wrote a business book, you know, it was called I'll Make You an Offer. And by the way, I never picked the titles of anything, but I'll Make You an Offer. Mm. You can't refuse obvious reasons. But, right. You know, when you are on the street, you live by the philosophy of Machiavelli. He was like the patron saint in the mob, if you know who Machiavelli was, 16th century Italian statesman. And his philosophy was that you can do anything that you need to do to maintain control or power over your kingdom. You can lie, you can steal, you can cheat, you can do anything, but on the outside, you always have to give the impression that you're honest, upright, and have integrity. And that's pretty much the mob way. Mm. You know, we're like, you know, you're above everything, but underneath, you're doing all the wrong things. And so when I was on the street, to a great degree, that was my philosophy. When I came to Christ, I was fascinated with Solomon in the book of Proverbs. And I see really there's two ways to live your life, two ways to deal. You either deal the Solomon way or you deal it the Machiavelli way. And I applied that to my business, and that's what the book is about. It's a comparison of the two ways to live. And obviously, Solomon is the way to do business. He's right.
So let me ask you the obvious question. So if I was like this ex-mob guy, you know, and I had to do time in prison and all the stuff that you had to go through, and there was probably guys out there that didn't like me, you know, and I was, you know, I had, you know, my guys were all in New York. Do you ever get a little nervous just walking around New York a little bit?
You know,
like somebody's out there, you know?
Listen, I never sell my former associates short, But understand this. Number one, I never put anybody in prison. I didn't betray them in that way. I didn't testify against people.
So you just confessed your own sins. You didn't confess theirs.
I confessed my own sins. I talked about the life, which is enough to get you in trouble, contract on my life. My father disowned me for many, many years until God allowed that to come together again. But I never lived in fear. You know, I realized something. God always prepares you for what's going to happen later on. Amen. Always. Now, during my time in that life, I never dreamed of the fact that I was going to walk away. It wasn't even a thought, never on my radar screen. But about 2 years before I met my wife, I had an incident where, you know, one of the evils of that room, that life is your best friend walks you into a room, you don't walk out again. You don't know you're in trouble, you're gone. And unfortunately, I've experienced that in my life. Well, one night I had that walk, and it was either the shortest or the longest walk of my life, because quite honestly, I was scared, heart beating through my chest. People asked me, why didn't you cut and run? It was robotic. It wasn't heroic. I just said, hey, if this is it, this is it. And obviously, I'm here. It was a tense night, but I think God showed me at that point. I didn't know 2 years later I was going to walk away, but he showed me that I could face death if I need to. So he prepared me in certain ways, and I can spend the rest of the evening about how God prepared me for what was going to happen later on. And that's why we have such a gracious Lord. He does prepare us. He doesn't just throw us into the fire. Amen?
There was one scripture There was a scripture that permeated through your books and through your testimony that really was a turning point for you when dealing with your old life bleeding into your new life. When a man's ways please the Lord.
Even his enemies are at peace with him.
Even his enemies are at peace with him. So as long as you can make your life please God, God can take care of your enemies. Yes. Even in Psalms, it says he can prepare a table before you in the presence of your enemies. Sometimes he doesn't take the enemies away, but he will give you a chance to prepare a table and to prosper and to live on even while they're still there. And that's what you have been able to do. What keeps you the busiest nowadays?
I speak, you know, God has honored the ministry that I have, a speaking ministry. I work a lot with the young people, with youth, but I'm in a different church every weekend for the past, you know, 12, 13 years. This movie has come out, a lot of more activities around my ministry now. I'm doing a lot of television stuff. I know you've seen that. But basically, anything that I do in some way has to be involved with my ministry. I don't want to do anything outside of that. But, you know, one thing that I always like to bring out, when I came to Christ, I didn't immediately accept him. I didn't. You know, I've been to trial 5 times. I've been to more grand juries than there are people in this room. I mean, I know every standard of proof that exists in our criminal justice system, not by choice, but by necessity, because that's where I grew up. But when I came to Christ, I really challenged him. I said, you know what, God, I made 2 serious mistakes in my life. I took a blood oath. Look where it got me. It got me in a bad situation in a prison cell. I said, twice I made wrong decisions. I can't do it a third time. And what I needed to really see was the evidence. I said, God, I'm putting you to the test. I'm challenging you. And you know what, Carmen? He didn't get mad at me. He didn't say, how dare you challenge me. I think what he said is, if you're ready to open up your stubborn heart and your mind, I'm ready to show you because I am God. And I'll tell you this, I was with some friends earlier today, but they asked me, I spent 29 months and 7 days. I spent 8 years altogether in prison, but 29 months and 7 days in the hole, 24/7, me and God. And during that time, I read my Bible inside out and upside down. There's more of my notes on that than there is scripture. And I read over 400 books on every faith, because I was really challenging God and putting him to the test. And I came away believing 1,000% that the Bible is God's word and that Jesus is our risen Savior.
If somebody wants to get a hold of you, they may want you to come and speak at their function or their church. You got a website or something like that they can go to?
Yeah, my website is michaelfrancis.com, just my name.com. I'm on Facebook and Twitter. If you're interested in the movie, it's godthefathermovie.com. It'll be out Easter time, and I will tell you this, Jesus is honored in a huge way in that movie.
Hallelujah.
Amen, for sure.
Michael, thank you. Thanks once again for coming.
And I want to tell you, I love this guy. I love this guy.
In another life, I would have been working for you. I would have been working for you.
I might have been working for you.
I don't know, man. I would have been your driver or something like that. Who knows? I think we need to get Vashawn Mitchell back out here. He's anointed. He's got a word from God in every one of his songs. Michael, thank you. Please welcome Vashawn Mitchell singing God, My God. Thank you, brother.
You know there's power in the name of God. Come on. All over the building. All over the world. Though we try to define you, attempt to describe you, it's hard to exemplify your word. Even I call you great, and you are the greatest. Sometimes I just should call upon your name. In your name there is safety and security, and whosoever calls on you can be saved.
Thank you, God.
Oh God, your name has so much strength. Your name alone is strong. For you are God.
You are God.
God, my God. And heaven and earth shall pass away, but your name will remain, and everyone will declare that you are God.
Yes, heaven and earth shall, come on.
Yes, heaven and earth shall pass away.
Put your name, Father.
God always acknowledges great ministries with his presence. That's the most important thing. Speaking of, our next guest is one of the most fascinating people to have on as a guest, because he always has such heavy things to say, yet they're practical, yet they're scary, yet they fill you with hope. And it's like everything he says is like you're watching a movie, you know, and you just say, I never knew that. And you're fascinated by it. He has he's the best-selling author of the book The Harbinger. He is the president He's the president of Hope of the World Ministries, the senior pastor and Masonic rabbi of the Jerusalem Center at Beth Israel in Wayne, New Jersey. I've been there. It's a wonderful church. An international teacher who broadcasts daily over hundreds of radio stations throughout the U.S. and World TV. He's just full of revelation and knowledge and wisdom and insight, and he's just fascinating. And he's a little scary, too, because he knows things that nobody else knows. But he's here tonight to reveal them. Would you please welcome Jonathan Kahn? There he is. Thank you, my brother.
Thank you.
You always have something interesting to say about something that, like we could pick a word, and something that we're not so familiar with, and when you start to explain it, it just relates to everything that has to do with all of our lives.
Yeah.
Now, one of the questions that they have to give me, they say, what is the mystery of the Shemitah?
Yes, you said it right.
So,
but let me say one thing.
Okay.
I'm not a Masonic rabbi, a Messianic rabbi. No Masonic.
Oh.
It's okay. Big little difference there.
Messianic. You know what? I'm so sorry.
No. It's okay. It's okay.
This is just a big deal for me.
No, it's okay.
You know, I got over. I get carried away.
Yeah. So make sure.
All right. Let's get back to the Shemitah.
Yes.
All right. So, the word Shemitah is a mystery to me.
Yeah.
So what does that mean for folks that may not have even heard that before?
Yeah. Well, the mystery of the Shemitah is the follow-up to the Harbinger, and just came out. The mystery of the Shemitah.
Harbinger is of things to come.
Yes. And right. So is the Shemitah. Things. It's of what was, what is. The mystery of the Shemitah is a biblical mystery, goes back 3,000 years to Moses, that God gave, that is really amazing because it is behind everything that has happened. It has affected our lives from the moment we were born. It is behind the rise and fall of the economy, the rise and fall of the stock market, the rise and fall of nations, including America, the rise and what may be the fall. It becomes a sign of judgment. It is actually one of the keys of the end times and events that have even taken place in our life with Israel. So it is such a big thing. I mean, it's such a colossal thing. And it is so specific that it actually gives dates, times of when things happen. I mean, down to the days, down to the seconds of what has happened in our lifetime.
Does the word Shemitah means what?
The Shemitah is every seventh day was a Sabbath day. Every seventh year, what a lot of believers don't know, it was a Sabbath year. The Sabbath year was called the Shemitah. And so every 7 years, they were resting. There was no sowing, no plowing, just a total rest.
A whole year?
A whole year of rest.
Oh.
Yeah.
What a great idea.
It was a great idea.
It worked 6 years, take a year off. Who's up for that? I think that's a great idea.
It's a great idea. Yeah, sounds all good. And not only that, added to that, on the last day of the Shemitah, something really unique happened that all the debts of the people were wiped away.
Oh! Oh! I'm liking the Shemitah already. This sounds great.
Yeah, just keep listening to
that. Yeah.
So on that day, it was called... The day was called Elul 29 on the calendar. All debts, all credit, the financial accounts of the nation wiped clean. Now, this was to be a blessing, but when Israel turned away from God, the Shemitah changes from a blessing to a sign of judgment. Okay, so actually, when the Jewish people were in captivity for 70 years, it was based on the Shemitahs that they did not observe. Because the Shemitahs are saying, God is in charge of everything. God is the Lord of everything. God is in charge of money. God's in charge of our possession. Everything comes from God. And if a nation turns away from God, this thing comes back to say, no, God is in charge. Okay, and so the thing is that now the question is, Could this actually be affecting us today? Could it? And the amazing thing, I mean, this first appeared in the Harbinger as one of the chapters. But I knew there was so much more to it. And only in the last, like in the spring, it started, more was coming on it, and that's where the new book came. So the thing is that, here's the thing. The Shemitah affects the economy. I mean, affects the, and today, the wiping out of financial accounts would be the crashing of stock markets. Okay, so here's the question here. Could it be affecting us today? Now, here it is. In the last 40 years, there have been 5 major financial collapses or long-term rises and falls, 5 of them since 1973. And here they are. 1973, first one, 1980, 1987, 2000 and 2007. There are five. Now, the thing is, now, one of the things about them is the Smita is a seven-year cycle. So the first thing that's kind of strange is that all of those dates are linked to the others by 7 years.
I was just adding that up in my head. Yeah,
in one into the one before the one after. But do any of them take place during God's appointed Shemitah? Do they? The answer is every single one of them. Every single 1973 year of the Shemitah, 1980 Shemitah, 1987 year of the Shemitah, 2000 and 2007 year of the Shemitah. Every single one happened, the wiping out of financial accounts. Now, it gets more, because what if you look at the last 100 years, okay, and look at the greatest crashes, the top crashes, do any of them take place at the time of the Shemitah? The answer is the majority of them do. The majority, in fact, the top three are the second Great Depression, 37 and 38 is the year of the Shemitah. The number two was the Great Recession, just happened. That was 2007 and 2008 it happens. That's the year of the Shemitah. The Great Depression's number one. That's the key year was 1930 and 31, year of the Shemitah. In fact, in 1937, when the Shemitah begins, next day Wall Street collapses, the next day. In the Great Depression, when the Shemitah reaches that peak day, Elul 29, when things are wiped away, ushers in the greatest month-long collapse in stock market history. But and beyond that, there's a certain time of the Hebrew year in the year when the Shemitah gets in effect. And that is called the month of Tishri. Tishri. Now, Tishri is a month that opens the Shemitah and closes it. So the question is, do any of the greatest day crashes take place around this time of when you have this appointed time of this financial collapse? And actually, Shemitah also means the collapse. You ask what it means. It can mean the release or the collapse. So the answer is the majority of the greatest day crashes have happened at the time of Tishri. That time, of all the times that could happen in the year, they cluster around this one time. And for ages, financial people have been mystified by a mystery that was, why do all these great crashes tend to take place around September, October? If you notice, these great crashes, Black Tuesday, Black Monday. Well, the answer, they could never find out, but the answer's in the Bible. Because God appointed, September and October is the Hebrew month of Tishri. That's the month that God appointed for this collapse. So you got all that. Now I'll give you just another thing, is if you look at the greatest point crashes, now these are the greatest volume crashes, the top five, do any of them take place around this Elul 29 wipeout, biblical wipeout day? The answer is every single one of them did. In fact, their proximity to that day is the average of about 99%. So now here's the other part. It's getting more intense. In the last two Shemitahs, it has increased, it has intensified.
And one of the 7 year cycles.
Yeah, it has. What's happened, it's gotten more intense, or you could say scary, but I could also say, you know, listen, it's also comforting that God is in charge of every single thing, you know? Yeah. I mean, that's the ultimate thing. Yeah. You know? And.
Am I adding something wrong? Because you said 2007
right.
Plus 7 is 2014. Are we involved in something? Are we about to see something?
Well, surprise. We are.
I'm adding this stuff in my head, you know.
Yeah. The Shemitah, well, I'm going to get to, because this is what it's all getting to. This is getting to now. This is why people were, you know, the publisher, I wasn't going to write a book. The publisher said, listen, it's approaching the year of the Shemitah. Everybody's asking. Yes, the Shemitah has just begun. It just began in September 2014. It goes to September 2015. It's at the end of the Shemitah where you get this wipeout time. Now, I'll talk about the future, because we know we're going to talk about that. But let me just say this. The last two times have been the year 2001. That was the Shemitah happens. When you get to the last week, that peak week, that heading to the wipeout, what happens is 9/11 happens. And 9/11 shuts down Wall Street, and Wall Street's paralyzed. It opens up the next week, and the day it opens up, September 17th, is the greatest stock market crash in history up to that day. When did that take place? The greatest stock market crash in history to that day took place on Elul 29, the biblical day appointed by God, the Shemitah, the day of wiping away financial accounts concerning a nation that is turning away from God. And that once knew God, but is turning away. Now that record lasts for 7 years. Then comes the Great Recession. The Great Recession, you get the peak of the Great Recession, the greatest collapse, and this one is the greatest collapse to this day in world history, happened September 29, 2008. They go into the stock market, a little bit down the street here, go in there. The opening bell refuses to ring that morning. Even Wall Street took it as a sign. What happens is you have the greatest collapse on that day. What day was that? Elul 29, the exact biblical Shemitah that God appointed. The two greatest collapses in American history to those days each happened on the exact same day given in the Bible that happens to be the day that God appointed to wipe away financial accounts concerning a nation turned away from God. And they are separated by exactly 7 biblical years to the day, to the hour, to the second, to the bell. That's how exact God is. And only God could have put that together. And the warning of the Shemitah is, and this is why I'm saying it's getting more intense, and we'll talk about the future with this, but it's getting more intense. The warning is for a nation that has turned away from God. The Shemitah can mean release, and you know, you looked at the good side of it, but it can also mean the collapse or the fall. The warning is our blessings come only from God. And we cannot turn away from God, we cannot turn against God, we cannot rule him out of our lives and expect the blessings of God to remain on this land. And on. That's the warning of the future.
So, if you can predict right to the day, you would know, like, the day before something's going to happen. You could, like, show up and put a sign, say, tomorrow.
The end is near.
Yeah.
Let me say this. I put two cautions, and the two cautions are, we never want to put God in a box. God doesn't have to do anything according to our schedule or according to what we think. And the Shemitah, the cycle of the Shemitah sometimes is stronger, sometimes weaker. God doesn't have to do anything. However, that's the first caution. The second caution is he might. And I would be aware. I'd be aware of the signs. I'd be aware of where we're heading. We are already, as a nation, rapidly, rapidly defying God in his ways. I mean, it's sweet. Since we were last here, I mean, it's amazing what has already happened, and it's accelerating. So, you know, God is just, and God is merciful, and God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he will act consistently. And so the thing is that, you know, we'll talk about that, you know, but also to say it's even bigger, because one of the mysteries in the book is called The Rise and Fall of Nations. And one of the things is, it's not only the economy, but actually nations fall according to the Shemitah and rise. And I'll give you an example. One example, in 1917, it's a year of the Shemitah. What happens, you have the greatest shaking of nations in world history to that day. You have World War I. And it's the turning point. And you got the collapse of the Russian Empire. Remember, Shemitah means collapse. Collapse of the Turkish Empire, Austrian Empire, all these were. And you have the rising of one power, the rise of America. America's rise as a world superpower comes from that Shemitah when it enters World War I. That's the beginning. If you go, four cycles forward, and that takes you to the Shemitah of 1945, another global cataclysm in the world. And that, now you got that going on. That the World War II, the conflict begins when Hitler seizes Austria, seizes Czechoslovakia. That happened in 1938. That was the year of the Shemitah. Then you have a 7-year cycle. The war follows the Shemitah. It goes to 1945, the year of the Shemitah. And when the Shemitah ends, the first week of September, World War II ends the same week. Everything follows that. And not only do you have the collapse of powers, but you also have the rise of America to superpower. 1945, America becomes really, it's the American age all over the world. And you got the Cold War, all that with the Shemitah. Let's go 4 cycles forward. It takes you to another key year, 1973. It's a year when America makes a fateful decision to kill its unborn children. Mm. The same sin that led to Israel's destruction. It happens, and that same month, the financial world starts to collapse. That same year, America loses its first war in the modern time, Vietnam. Mm-hmm. Happens on August 15th. That is the same exact date that America won World War II on August 15th on the other Shemitah, fall. If you go 4 more Shemitahs, it brings you to 2001. When you get to that last week and you have 9/11. Now remember, the Shemitah means the shaking, can mean the fall, can mean the collapse. You literally have the collapse of the towers that represent America's power and glory.
Now, you have a roll-in of something you said.
Okay.
So yeah. we have that ready.
Sure. What it is this.
Set it up.
Yeah. I want to give, first of all, listen, the Lord is on the throne, and the thing is that God will give openings for his people. And the thing is that the dark gets darker, the lights have to get brighter, and we have to get stronger. It's not the time to be timid. And so while this is happening, The Harbinger, when it came out, The Harbinger caused a man to start prayer on Capitol Hill every week. That's what happened. So they invited me to come to this gathering of members of Congress and leaders and national leaders, and Ted Cruz was there and Mike Huckabee, and we got to make the most of it. So I just, this is as an encouragement. This is on Capitol Hill to members of Congress, and the Lord opened the door, as he will for God's people.
Okay, so we have that ready.
Capitol Hill, in a city named after the one who gave that prophetic warning, to ask, can a nation drive out the name of God from its public squares and the word of God from its schools and the ways of God from its culture and still expect the smiles of God to shine upon it? Can the blood of 50 million unborn children cry out to heaven from this land and the smiles of heaven still remain? Members of Congress, can a government call good evil and evil good and forge laws that war against the laws of the Almighty and the smiles of heaven still remain? Supreme Court justices, can you strike down the statutes of the Almighty and overturn the judgments of the Most High and still expect the smiles of heaven to remain? And Mr. President, can you place your left hand on the word of God to assume your office and then with your right hand sign laws that break the very word upon which you swore and still expect the smiles of heaven to remain? The voice of our first president cries out to us tonight and answers, no, you cannot do so, and still expect the smiles of heaven to remain upon this land. Kingdoms rise and kingdoms fall. America has risen by the hand of God, and without that hand, it cannot endure. The voice of God cries out, return, America, and I will have mercy on you. And tonight we bear witness from Capitol Hill that the warning of our first president is true, and that our hope is not in the White House or the Supreme Court or the Capitol or Wall Street. Our hope is in the living God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Our hope is in Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah, the same yesterday, today, and forever. To him alone the nation is dedicated, and him alone is his salvation. So let the word go forth this night to this nation. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their evil ways, I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. Let the will of God be done, let the name of God be lifted up, and let this city on the hill again shine with the light of the fire of the glory of the living God in the name of Yeshua, Jesus, the light of the world, the glory of Israel, and the hope of these United States. So help us God. Amen.
Now, this was in Washington.
This was in the Capitol building.
In the Capitol building.
Yeah, Mike Huckabee introduced me, and you had leaders all.
So all the politicians are there.
You had a good amount of politicians there, yeah.
Well, you really stood out like a sore thumb that day.
Well, we have to be willing to stand out. We have to be willing to stand out. Because if we don't, that's going to be the problem. God has called us to shine. You know, it's kind of like things are returning to as they were in the beginning, Book of Acts, where you have we want to go back to the Book of Acts. You have an ungodly culture, ungodly, and yet the people of God shone like torches. This is the time to shine. That's what, we cannot be timid. We have to be bold for God in love. You know. And, you know, so the mystery is saying, get ready. I'll tell you one thing that's already happened since this Shemitah year began. One thing that's already happened. I've warned of this. It's in the Harbinger, and it's in the mystery of the Shemitah book. And that is that as of, I think about within like 1 month of the Shemitah beginning, America lost its crown as the world's strongest economic power.
Right.
The American age, which began in 1871, ended in the Shemitah when China took over. And the warning of God is that we cannot go without him. So the signs are happening, and even the harbingers are continuing. Last time I was with you, I talked to you about the tree of hope, this tree, this biblical sign right down at ground zero. And this biblical sign, well, since I last spoke to you, it's dead. It is gone. The tree of hope representing America and coming back has been destroyed. It was destroyed on a Hebrew holy day. And it was that night came the first blood moon, that whole period thing. Mm. It started with that. The signs are continuing, and so we have to be stronger. And that's the whole point. God has called us. You know, and the other thing is, if you are not in God, those who are watching, here's the message, is this. If you are not in God, get in God, because I say this in Hebrew. This is the one Hebrew word to remember. In Hebrew, the word for safety is Yeshua. And Yeshua is Jesus. He's our safety. He's our rock. He's everything. So don't fear. Just be right with God. Just get your life right with God. Right. Be ready. Be ready. I mean, I do give dates and I do this thing, but the point is, no matter what happens and when it happens, we're all going to stand before God. Be ready, because we have to be right with God. And if you are in God and there's something in your life that shouldn't be, now is the time to get it out. And if God is calling you, now is the time to say yes. Don't say tomorrow, because the time is late and God is real. Amen. Behind everything.
Wow. Brother. If somebody wants to, now the Harbinger, that's the last book?
The Harbinger was the first book, that's still out. The other one is The Mystery of the Shemitah that just came out. That's kind of the follow-up from that. And
that's wherever
available books are everywhere. Sold. Both are available everywhere. If they want to get in touch, it's hopeoftheworld.org on the right. And in the area, we're at the Jerusalem Center, Beth Israel, right here. 20 minutes from here. So, yeah.
Brother, thank you so much.
I mean, My blessing. Thank you.
I told you. And China is the new economic superpower.
Yeah.
So if you have any Chinese friends, treat them right.
If you have a Jewish friend, treat him right.
Okay.
Treat him right up there.
It'll be better.
One Jewish friend, treat him right. It'll be okay.
We have Vashon Mitchell is going to be coming out and singing a song. He has a worship medley that he's known for. He's going to come out and he's going to sing that. And right after that, Pastor Frank Santoro is going to come out with a special word about the alabaster box that he's been working on. And he's one of the best looking Italian guys you're ever going to meet. He's got a nice red tie. Treat him with give him a lot of love here tonight. He's got an anointed message. So let's welcome Vashon Mitchell with that great worship medley. Thank you, brother.
Thank you, bro.
Thank you, bro. And with those same hands, can we lift them all over the place and worship God? Come on. Create an atmosphere wherever you are. If you know that you have victory because God died for you, lift a sound everywhere in the world. Can we say it together? Say hallelujah. King.
You are the risen King,
and you're seated in majesty.
Seated in majesty.
You are the risen King, yeah.
You are the risen King.
All over the world, sing it, say hallelujah.
It
never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up. It never runs out on me.
Your love
never fails and never gives up. Never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up. It never runs out on me. Yeah.
Your love never fails, never gives up.
Yeah. It never runs
out on me.
Your love never fails. Plans for me. Father, goes beyond my wildest dream. Can we sing unto the Lord, say, my God, he's big, and he's so strong, and he's a mighty God. He is my refuge. He's the rock on which I stand. He's my God.
He's my God.
He's my refuge.
He is my refuge.
He's a
he's the rock
on which I stand. And he's my fortress.
He's my fortress.
My God, he is my life.
My God, he is my life.
And he holds.
He holds the ocean in.
And there's nothing my God cannot do. There's nothing my God cannot do. Can we worship God tonight?
There's nothing my God cannot do.
For he's an amazing God, and there's nothing. I searched all over, couldn't find nobody.
Come on, somebody. Let's give God some praise in the house. I love talking about the goodness of God. Talking about how big God is. There is nothing that God can't do. No situation that you face that God can't turn around. There's nothing that God cannot do. Hallelujah. Somebody say, praise the Lord. You can be seated. God is so good. I'll tell you, there is just an anointing when you talk about the goodness of God.
Yes.
You know, of all the things that God wants to show us, I believe he wants to show us his goodness.
Yes.
You remember when Moses said to God, he said, God, I want to see what you look like. Yes. You know,
And what did God say? He said, I'm going to hide you in the cleft of the rock. And he said, I'm going to make all my goodness to pass by you. Of all the things that God would show us, he would show us his goodness. And tonight I want to talk to you about a principle that can set you up for God's goodness. I want to talk to you about how God can script a story that can absolutely change your future. Yeah. Say, Pastor, what are you talking about? I'm talking about the story behind the seed, the story behind the seed. Did you know that every time you and I sow seed into God's kingdom, we are telling a story and we are creating a story? Our seed tells a story. And if that doesn't make sense, I want you to turn in your Bible to John chapter 11 and also to Luke chapter 7. And we're going to flesh this thing out. And as you're turning there, let's just invite the Lord's presence as if he's not already here. But let's just ask him to bless the word. Father, we just lift ourselves up to you right now. We pray that you would speak to each heart watching all around the world, that you would deliver a life-changing message in Jesus' name. Amen. As you're turning to John chapter 11, let me alert you to the fact that the chapter begins with the greatest miracle that Jesus ever did, recorded for us in the Bible, other than his own resurrection. It's the raising of Lazarus from the dead and the absolute joy that that brought to Lazarus's family, namely the close friends of Jesus, who was Mary, Martha, and of course, Lazarus. This was a family that Jesus spent lots and lots of personal time with, away from the hustle and the bustle of ministry and the people pulling on him and criticizing him. Matter of fact, Jesus visited this house on a frequent basis. He probably spent holidays there. He crashed there when he was tired and needed to get away. He was so comfortable with this particular family that he would stop over unannounced with 12 of his friends just to have lunch. How many of you know you got to be close with somebody to stop at their house unannounced with 12 friends and them not throw you out and slam the door in your face? But when he got there, they opened the door and they welcomed him in. You remember the story where Martha was serving frantically and Mary was seated at the feet of Jesus. Jesus loved this family so much that he did an amazing miracle for them. But the question that I want us to explore tonight is, what was the catalyst to the miracle? What was the event that triggered the greatest miracle that Jesus ever did, other than his own resurrection as recorded for us in the Bible? And the answer is found in John chapter 11, if you have your Bible. Here's what the scripture says, beginning in verse 1. It says, a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary who anointed the Lord with fragrant oil and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. I want you to pay particular attention to the description given to us of Mary. It says, therefore, the sisters sent to him saying, Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick. Now, this is a strange detail to put in the Bible, isn't it? I mean, Jesus loves everybody, doesn't he? Amen. Why do we need to know, Lord, the one that you love is sick? Jesus loves everybody, red and yellow, black and white. We're all precious in his sight, right? But the Bible goes out of its way to tell us that the message they got to Jesus was, the one you love is sick, indicating to us that God wants us to realize this is a special relationship. This is not an ordinary, just kind of run-of-the-mill relationship. These are people that Jesus was tight with. And it says, therefore, the sister sent to him saying, Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick. And when Jesus heard this, he said, the sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it. What was the catalyst to this great miracle? Verse 2 said, this was the Mary, the same Mary, who anointed the Lord with the fragrant oil and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Mary, the sister of Lazarus, is one and the same with the woman who broke the alabaster box of costly perfume and anointed the feet of Jesus with it. Now, I need to tell you that there is a little debate in the body of Christ and amongst theologians about these alabaster box anointings, the who's and the when's and the where's and all of that. It appears in all four Gospels. It appears in Matthew 26 and in Mark 14 and in Luke chapter 7 and in John chapter 12. And one account says it happened in the home of Simon the leper. In another account, it says it happened in the home of Simon the Pharisee. And so two different locations, which tells us two separate alabaster box anointings. The real debate, though, is were they done by the same person? Because in some of the accounts, we read that it was a sinful woman who anointed Jesus with the alabaster box. And in other occasions, we are told that it was Mary, the sister of Lazarus. Now, I've got to tell you that I studied this every which way you can study this. I called every theologian that I know. I looked it up in every commentary that I could find. And here's the conclusion that I came to. Two separate anointings, both done by the same Mary. Mary, who at first was a sinner, but after she met Jesus, was no longer identified as a sinner, but as the sister of Lazarus. And so I want us to peer into this story found in Luke chapter number 7, because this act of breaking the alabaster box and anointing Jesus with the contents of the very costly perfume was the catalytic agent to the greatest miracle that Jesus ever did. And if we can see a principle in here about the power of sowing seed into the gospel, and we can put it into practice, we can set ourselves up to receive any miracle that we need from the Lord. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Mary's gift was the catalytic agent, and it wasn't a cheap gift. It wasn't a small gift. It wasn't a gift that she could do without. It was the most significant seed that she could sow into the ministry of Jesus. And this extravagant seed that she sowed tells us a story about Mary and creates a story for Mary. And I want you to know that every time you sow seed into the gospel, you are telling a story and you are creating a story. Look at it with me. Luke chapter number 7, beginning in verse 36. The scripture says, then one of the Pharisees asked him to eat with him. And he went to the Pharisee's house and he sat down to eat. And behold, a woman in the city who was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus was at the table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of fragrant oil and stood at his feet behind him weeping. And she began to wash his feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head. And she kissed his feet and anointed them with the fragrant oil. Now, when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he spoke to himself, saying, this man, if he were a prophet, would know who and what manner of woman this is who's touching him, for she's a sinner. And Jesus answered and said, hold on. He spoke to himself. He never vocalized what he was speaking to himself. He never vocalized what he was thinking, but Jesus answered him anyway. See, we're not dealing with an ordinary person when we deal with Jesus. We're dealing with the Lord of glory who knows what's going to come out of our mouth, even while it's still in our heart and on our mind. And Jesus answered and said, Simon, I have something to say to you. And he said, teacher, say it. There was a certain creditor who had two debtors. One owed him 500 denarii, the other 50. And when they had nothing with which to repay, he freely forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love them more? Aren't you glad Jesus always sets us up for an easy question? He doesn't try to trick us. He's not out to get us. He just wants us to get it. He's made it simple. I mean, how simple can it be? Jesus loves me. This I know, 'cause the Bible tells me so. It's simple. The gospel message has to be made complicated. And so he said, tell me, therefore, which of them will love him more? Simon answered and said, I suppose the one who forgave him more. And Jesus is going, man, you got it. And he said, you have rightly judged. It was the only time the entire night that Simon judged correctly. And then he turned to the woman and he said to Simon, do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head. You gave me no kiss, but this woman has not ceased to kiss my feet since the time I came in. You did not anoint my head with oil, but this woman has anointed my feet with fragrant oil. Therefore, I say to you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loves little. And then he said to her, your sins are forgiven. Let me give you the setting as Luke records it. Jesus has been invited to the house of Simon the Pharisee for an aristocratic dinner party where all of the who's who in and around Jerusalem are invited to come. And dinner parties back in Bible times were not like dinner parties today. They had these tables in the outer courts of their house, in the open air of their house, and around this table were porticos, and the front door was left open so that people from off the street could fill the porticos and watch as all of the bigwigs sat around the table and talked about the issues of the day. And this was like their nightly entertainment. This is something that they did because they didn't have Praise the Lord to watch. And so they went and they watched these people sit at the table and just begin to chat. And this evening, there was going to be some deep discussion because Jesus was at the table. Now, here are the players in the event. Jesus, first of all, is there. He needs no introduction. That's why when Moses asked him and said, who should I say has sent me? And he said, tell him, I am has sent me. I mean, he's saying, you know, I don't need an introduction. I am who I am. I'm the king of the universe, the Lord of glory, the Pharisees' worst nightmare, the sinner's savior, and the friend of sinners. He was in the house. But then we also have Simon, who is in the house, not to be confused with Simon Peter or Simon the Zealot or Simon the Leper or Simon Cal. His occupation is teacher and guardian of the law and part of the religious sect known as the Pharisees. He has various aliases, namely whitewashed tombstone, hypocrite, and blind God. He's curious. He is cynical, he is pious, he is prejudiced, he's arrogant, he feels a little bit superior, and he doesn't think that he needs to be forgiven of too much because he's a good guy. Simon is in the house. And then, of course, you have the sinful woman, a.k.a. Mary, the sister of Lazarus, better known as the town prostitute, probably estranged from her family because they're embarrassed of what she does. She's outwardly aggressive, but she's inwardly broken. She has a hole in her heart from an apparent hurt, and she's looking for love in all the wrong places. But somewhere along the line, and prior to this night of entertainment, she has had an encounter with Jesus that has changed her entire life. She was touched by a man in a way that didn't make her feel guilty. She was touched by the master, and she was freed, and she was forgiven, and she decides, I've got to go to the house where I hear Jesus is going to be, because I can't get enough of this Jesus. I'll tell you what, we need to have a passion for more of Jesus. And so she comes into the portico among the crowd because she's got to get close to Jesus. She can't get enough. He's done something that has changed her life, and she's watching as Jesus arrives, and Simon, the host, doesn't greet him with a kiss. She watches as Simon doesn't give Jesus any water to wash his dusty feet. She watches as Simon does not anoint the head of Jesus with oil, as was the custom whenever you had an honored guest come in your home. And she's watching all of this rude behavior toward her newly found Savior, who she loves with all of our heart, and she can't stand it anymore. And she decides to come out from the crowd and become part of the committed. And she bolts out from the portico and makes a beeline to Jesus, and she takes her position at his feet. Amen. See, she understood something that we all need to understand, that we belong at the feet of Jesus. And when she comes there, she becomes unglued. And this woman, who is a sinner and is not supposed to know anything about protocol and how to treat the Messiah and the Savior, all of a sudden begins to send a message to all of the people who are supposed to know. And she looks and she says, you won't wash his feet, I will wash them with my tears. And you won't wipe his feet, I'll wipe them with my hair. And you won't kiss him, I'll kiss his feet continuously. And you won't anoint him with oil, I won't give him the cheap stuff. I will take that which cost me everything, and I will break it and pour out the best seed that I have on the feet of Jesus. Because I know who's in the house. You may not understand who's in the house. You may not understand the royalty that is among you. You may not understand that the King of Glory has come to visit us, but I know who he is because I know what he's done in my life. Now, here's the question. Why would she give such a significant seed? We know it cost 1 year's wages. That's what the value of it was. Jesus said, because her sins, which are many, are forgiven, she loves much. See, Jesus freed her. After the encounter with Jesus, which precipitated her arrival at the dinner party, she was changed. She got a phone call from a client. And she said, no, you don't need to call this phone anymore. Don't you understand? I'm not in that line of work anymore. Matter of fact, lose the number. Matter of fact, you don't have to lose the number because I'm shutting off the cell service. You know, I'm not in that business anymore. And then our pimp showed up at the door because he couldn't reach her by phone. And he knocked on the door and she opened it. He was angry. And he said, where have you been? And she said, I've been home and I don't work for you anymore. And you can kill me if you want to because I have a new Lord. I have a new Savior and his name is Jesus. She went to her Facebook. She took down all of the racy pictures and she took them off Instagram and Snapchat. She was changed. She was different. Which brings me to my first point. Our seed tells a spiritual story. Simon gave Jesus no kiss, no water to wash his feet, no oil to anoint his head. He gave Jesus nothing but an invitation to his party, not because he wanted Jesus there, but he was interested in using Jesus to draw a crowd. He invited Jesus to his party for his own agenda. Simon was confused like a lot of people are in this world that think that the party is at their table, but the woman who was a sinner understood that the party was at the feet of Jesus. And Simon's lack of a gift tells us a spiritual story about Simon, lost in his trespasses and sins. But Mary gave an extravagant seed, a treasure worth a year's salary when she had lost her job. She couldn't get another job because when you put prostitute for the last 20 years at the top of your resume, you're not getting hired. And she could have taken that seed and said, you know what? I'm going to keep that seed until people begin to respect me again, and I'm going to live off of that seed. But she came in contact with somebody who was greater than her situation and greater than her life and greater than her circumstances. She said, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to take this seed, which I need, and I'm going to sow it into your life, and I'm going to trust you to take me further than this seed could have taken me. And you know what her seed tells us? A story. Tells us a story that she was grateful. That she was once bound, but now she's free. She was lost, but now she's found. She was blind, but now she could see. She was guilty, but now she's forgiven. She was steeped in her sin and headed for a Christless eternity, but now she was on her way to heaven because of what Jesus did. Our seed tells a spiritual story. Here's what God said to me. The more significant the seed, the greater the gratitude. The greater the gratitude. Our seed tells a spiritual story. But our seed, number two, creates a future story. Here's her story. A prostitute has an encounter with Jesus. She's freed and forgiven. She gives Jesus an extravagant gift, which creates a bond and a relationship with Jesus and this family. Now, Mary, Martha, Lazarus, and Simon are all extremely close. This alabaster box, this gift, created a lifetime relationship. Now, Jesus is spending personal time at their house. He's coming over for dinner on short notice, and he's spending holidays, and he's connecting with Lazarus as his dear friend. They have the picture-perfect life. A sister and a daughter is rescued from prostitution. A family is put back together, and Jesus is hanging in their house. This is a great story. But it's not the end of the story. Because verse 2 said, it was that Mary who anointed the Lord with the fragrant oil and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. How many of you know, no matter how much you love Jesus, sometimes life bites? Sometimes life pops up on you and gets you when you least expect it. And so here Jesus is a close family friend, and Lazarus dies unexpectedly. Life bites them. But when life bit them, Mary had a significant seed already in the ground. Why is this detail in the story that connects it to the greatest miracle that Jesus ever did? It was not to identify Mary, because if all it was to identify Mary, it could have said this was the Mary who sat at the feet of Jesus while Martha served frantically. But it didn't give us that detail. It said, this is the same Mary that anointed the feet of Jesus with the alabaster box, letting us know that there is a connection between the significant seed that we sow and the miracle that we receive from Almighty God. The greatest miracle in the Bible happens because there is a significant seed sown. Mary didn't give this seed in anticipation of her brother's death. She gave it because she loved Jesus. And as far as she was concerned, she would have thought, man, it's a great story. My life has been changed. But here's the thing. God never forgets the seed that we sow. God never forgets the seed that we sow. And when we've got seed in the ground, here's what happens. When the enemy attacks, when the enemy comes in like a flood and he begins to cause chaos in our lives, here's what God did in this situation. God the Father looked at the seed that she had sown that he hadn't forgotten about, and he looked at Jesus and he said, let's create a story that will blow their mind, a story that will blow the roof off of their life. And friends, God wants to create a story for you. God wants to give you a story that will blow your mind. The scripture says he is the author and the finisher of our faith. See, we don't catch that, because when it says he's the author, it means that he is a writer. It means that he is scripting stories. He is scripting stories that have amazing endings and that have surprises in the end, and stories that make the haters hate, and stories that make you fall to your knees and cry holy. God has got a story that he wants to script for you. But here's the thing, and I need to let you in on the secret. No seed, no story. No seed. No story, no seed, no story, no seed, no story. Matter of fact, the story of redemption began as a seed was planted in the ground. The greatest of all the seeds, his name is Jesus Christ. And when God planted him in the ground, that seed created a redemption story that has changed the whole world. God is wanting you to have a story that will blow your mind. Listen to me, this isn't a get-rich-quick message. I hate those kind of messages. This isn't a trick to raise money. This is a spiritual principle to set you up for something that God wants to do in your life. This is an opportunity for all of us around the entire globe to sow significant seed. And what a great place to sow seed than TBN. The greatest propitiator of the gospel on the planet right now, the greatest vehicle that God is using in all the world to preach the gospel is TBN. And when we sow significant seed into the advancement of the gospel through TBN, we are setting ourselves up for a future story. We are declaring what our present spiritual story is, and then we are setting ourselves up for a future story that may just include the miracle that you need in your life. It may just include your wayward child coming back, your marriage being fixed, your finances having a breakthrough, your body being healed. This is an opportunity. And I want to encourage all of you watching around the entire world to take this opportunity right now to sow some significant seed into the ministry of TBN. Matter of fact, you can do that right now. There's a number on the bottom of your screen. We encourage you to call that number right now and plant your seed. And when you plant that seed, just sit back. Just get ready, because God's about to do something in your life that will rock your world. He's about to write a story that will totally revolutionize everything that you ever thought was possible for you. We want to thank you so much for tuning in to TBN tonight. On behalf of Matt and Lori and Paul and Jan, we just thank you so much for all of your support. We love you, and we know that God has an amazing, amazing plan in store for you. If you're watching and you felt God speaking to your heart and you want to give your life to Jesus Christ, we invite you also to call the number on the bottom of your screen right now and say, you know what? I want to give my life to Jesus. I want to give my life to the one who gave it all for me. God wants to receive you right now as his very own. Would you stand to your feet, put your hands together, and give God some praise? God loves you more than you will ever, ever know. And he's got a story for you. If you'll just get some seed in the ground, do it, and do it now. Can you say amen? God bless you. It's been
great to
be with
you. We're so glad you've been with us for Praise the Lord. TBN has a worldwide ministry. We need your love gifts, large or small, to help keep the gospel of Jesus Christ going around the world. So write today, Praise the Lord, P.O. Box A, Santa Ana, California, 92711. Or in Canada, write TBN, P.O. Box 768, Station B, Ottawa, Ontario, K1P 5P8. If you haven't asked Christ into your life, call a prayer partner now and pray to receive Jesus as Savior and Lord. Now, until next time, remember to praise the Lord.
This program has been brought to you through the prayers and contributions of our faithful partners throughout North America and the world.
TBN's Holy Land Experience in Orlando, Florida is an amazing place where you can encounter Jesus in many ways. See his miracles and love portrayed in stunning dramas presented throughout the day. Experience Holy Communion in the upper room.
This is my body, which is broken for you.
Be baptized in water outside the beautiful Church of All Nations and walk through incredible lifelike displays in the beautiful Christus Gardens. There are so many ways you will witness his love and grace for mankind.
Your faith has made you well.
Make the unforgettable journey through the Holy Land Experience in Orlando, Florida, a priority on your list.